grave he lay. Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day. Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose.
He arose
with a mighty triumph for his foes.
He arose.
He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose,
he arose,
he arose,
he arose.
Hallelujah, Christ arose.
Hey, good morning, church family. Happy Easter to every one of you watching. Thank you so much for joining our worship service today. If you're not a member of Mountain View or not a regular attender, maybe you're joining us via YouTube or Facebook, maybe a friend or a family member invited you. My name is Pastor Chad. I'm the assistant pastor here at Mountain View Bible Church in New Tripoli, Pennsylvania. So thank you for joining our worship service. We have a great day planned. Some powerful worship music, a wonderful message from the book of Romans from our senior pastor, Jeff Barbieri. And it's just going to be a great time of worship, even in this time of uncertainty and having to be apart. We believe that the risen King Jesus gives us hope and joy for our daily lives. So now as we prepare to sing, let's hear from our musicians, Mark and Karen. They're going to sing some worship music. And I would encourage you to sing along, worship where you are, worship the risen King Jesus.
He is risen!
He is risen indeed.
Thank you, Karen. Welcome to the Nelson household. And it's Easter morning and we're just so excited to worship our Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Savior and our Lord. Let's start off the singing by singing Christ Arose and Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Oh, in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus my
Jesus.
from Matthew chapter 28. It says, after the Sabbath, at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he is risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I've told you. So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, don't be afraid. Go and tell my brothers, and go to Galilee. There they will see me. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.
Amen, because he lives.
I believe in the Son.
Yeah. happy Resurrection Sunday. I'm Jeff Barbieri, and I have the privilege of being the lead pastor at Mountain View Bible Church in New Tripoli, Pennsylvania. I want to welcome our regular church family and all of you that are new to our ministry through the wonders of technology. This is certainly a very unique Easter Sunday, a Sunday when we all need a dose of God's hope. Back when I was a young man, a young boy, and I would face a trial or a situation or a difficult challenge, I would often go and speak to my mom, and she would say, "Jeffrey, have faith. Everything will work out okay." And you know, and over the years, her counsel proved to be true. Everything did seem to work out okay. And although her counsel was true, she never really gave me a reason why it was true. She didn't give me an objective reality behind that optimistic hope that she gave me. Hope sometimes can be empty optimism, not have a basis for it. And we need hope this morning, and we need an objective basis behind that hope. Think about this terrible situation our country is in right now with this coronavirus, the personal tragedy to so many people who have lost loved ones, the destruction of families, the devastation to our economy, the anxiety that is being caused to so many small business owners, the day-to-day worries of hourly people who don't know where the next paycheck is coming from. And we all have the concern, the true and real concern about getting the disease. And we all know that some people get it and it's not too devastating, and others get it and young people and they don't come out of the hospital. And so that's a great concern. None of us want it. Think about this as a unique Sunday here on Easter. It's the first Easter Sunday in the history of America where our churches are empty. And we need hope. On this day, Easter Sunday, April 12, 2020, we need an objective basis for our hope. And I believe that this little message that I'm going to share with you this morning will do that. As you read through the New Testament, you realize that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the foundation for real hope. We're going to study some key scriptures this morning, mostly from the book of Romans. If you received an email link to this link, you probably had it attached. It may be attached in the description below, some sermon notes. If you don't have the sermon notes, that's okay. Get a piece of paper and just jot down the three periods of life that God wants to give us hope through the resurrection of Christ. Open your Bibles or turn on your phone to the book of Romans. Because this morning we want to gain hope that comes from some of the key verses in the New Testament. We want to see how the resurrection of Jesus Christ establishes hope for us in three time periods of our life. The resurrection will establish hope in our past, in our present, and in our future. So with that little introduction, let's get this hope. I want to direct your attention first and foremost to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, establishing hope in regards to our past. Now that may sound a bit strange because hope is usually optimism about a future event. But if we define hope as an emotion of positiveness, we'll see that we need to deal with our past because our past is with us in the present. Things that have happened to us in the past are with us in the present, and those things rob our hope. And we don't have to start with our past life. We have to go back much further. In fact, we have to go back to the book of Genesis chapter 3, where we see when mankind turned from God. When Adam and Eve walked away from God in the first sin of rebellion, immediately they had a sense of alienation, condemnation, and separation. Adam hid. The first emotion that's found in the Bible is in Genesis 3:10. And Adam heard God coming and he was afraid. The core emotion of mankind is fear, anxiety, insecurity. He then hid. It said, I was naked, so I hid myself. He was ashamed. And he hid. He dealt with the shame by hiding. Now, if it stopped with Adam, it wouldn't be too bad. But Romans chapter 5, verse 12 says that the sin of Adam passes through all man. Just like I have brown eyes because my mom and dad have brown eyes. The sin principle in the human race passes down from person to person. And so we come into this world with an indwelling concept of sin, a sense of alienation and separation. And then we have other people in our lives who are maybe doing the best they can, who are also people in Adam, and they sin against us. Maybe intentionally, maybe unintentionally. And then to put the icing on the cake, or the cherry on the cake, we have our own sin. We do our own things where we go against God's perfect standards, and we make mistakes, we make wrong decisions, and all of that works together to make us have a sense of low self-esteem and a sense of guilt, a sense of shame. Back when I was studying psychology and criminal justice in my undergraduate work, this concept of low self-esteem, whether it was a class in abnormal psychology or juvenile delinquency or social psychology, always came up as a core factor in people's emotional problems or behavioral problems. Secular psychology has done a great job in identifying a symptom, but they don't understand the cause. The cause is that mankind was made to be in a relationship with Jesus Christ, a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And because of that, there's this and this sense of shame, guilt is real because sin is real. The great news is that Jesus Christ has taken care of that. If you have sermon notes or if you'd like to turn to the book of Romans chapter 4 and verse 25. Because in the book of Romans, Paul is talking about all the great work that Jesus Christ has done for humankind. And in verse 25, we have this tremendous verse that relates his death and resurrection to dealing with our past. In Romans chapter 4, verse 25, we read, he was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. When the scripture says Jesus was delivered up for our trespasses, that speaks about the work of the cross. Jesus came as the God-man. He was born that first Christmas day, the God-man. He lived a perfect life. He then died on the cross, taking the sins of mankind, taking your sin, my sin, the sin of every person. When John the Baptist first saw Jesus, he looked and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Jesus was the sacrificial lamb. All the Passover lambs, all the sacrificial lambs of Israel, all for thousands of years pointed to the sacrificial lamb. When we think of Christianity, we think of the cross, the eternal symbol. Here's where Jesus shed his blood and paid for our sins. But the cross is only half the story. There's another half of the gospel. The gospel, this verse also says that Jesus was raised for our justification. In order for us to be declared righteous, Jesus had to be resurrected. The gospel is two parts. Paul defines the gospel in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He says, "I declare unto you the gospel, how Christ died for our sins, how he was buried, how he rose again on the third day." The gospel message, the good news that all of our sins are forgiven, are encapsulated in both his death and his resurrection. Both his death and his resurrection. By his death, he pays the penalty for our sin. And by his resurrection, he breaks the power of sin. Now, I mentioned before, we kind of have this uneasy feeling of guilt and shame. How can we be free of that? Well, think about, you've set a dinner party. And you've got your guests, you're all in the dining room. And just when you're about ready to begin dinner, you hear a knock at the back kitchen door. And you go there, and there's an uninvited guest knocking on the back door. You don't have another place set. You don't have enough food. And so you walk him through the kitchen. You open the basement door, and you throw him down the steps. He tumbles down the steps. You close the door. You lock it. You go back, and you sit with your guest. And you think, I took care of that. Well, unfortunately, the guest revives. He makes a terrible racket. He's banging on the door. He wants to get up. He wants to get out. He wants to eat. He's out of sight, but he's not out of mind. And when we suppress the sense of guilt, shame, alienation, separation that comes from the sin of Adam, from the sin of others against us, and our sin, it's like you shoved the unwelcome guest down the steps. He's out of the guilt, the shame, the sense of insecurity is out of sight, but it certainly is not out of mind. You know, in the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, verse 14, it says, Jesus Christ offered himself by the eternal spirit so that he might cleanse our conscience. Christians are people that have trusted what Jesus Christ has done by his death and resurrection. And their conscience is clear, not because of what they've done, not because they're perfect, but because Jesus Christ, the God-man, died and rose again. Now you might say, Pastor, if you only knew what I have done, if you only knew how terrible my sin was and is, you'd say, certainly Jesus could not have died for me. If you say, Pastor, if you only knew what people have done to me, how I'm defined by the acts of violence and abuse done to me. Well, friends, I do not know your sin, and I don't know the sin that was done to you. But I do know that there's the God-man who died, who was perfect, who died and rose again, and that is greater than your sin. And you could find relief there. As we close this message, I'll show you and invite you to receive Jesus Christ. But before we do that, let's move on to the second time period. The second time period where we are gain hope. The resurrection of Jesus establishes hope regarding our presence, regarding our present time. The book of Acts tells us that after Jesus Christ rose from the dead, Acts chapter 1 says he lived among the apostles for 40 days with many proofs of his resurrection. The Bible then tells us in Acts chapter 1 verses 9 through 11 that Jesus ascended bodily to heaven. And today he's enthroned in heaven at the right hand of God. Well, you may think that God has left us alone now to struggle and trudge through the Christian life on our own. In the upper room discourse in John chapters 13 through 16, when Jesus, just hours before his arrest, he spent much of his time talking to the disciples about his departure. And one of the topics that he encouraged them was that he was going to go away and send the Holy Spirit to them. In fact, he said in John chapter 14 that he would come again to them. He would not leave them orphans. And in that context, it's the sending of the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, we see the Holy Spirit is sent to the church. And we come to the next verse in Romans that talks about how Jesus is giving us hope in the present. Three ways he wants to give us hope in the present. First, he indwells us, Romans 8, 9. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit that was promised that he sent, he indwells, lives in the Christian. Look at Romans 8, 9. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God lives in you, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. A person who accepts Jesus Christ as Savior is immediately indwelled by the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity. Jesus said he wouldn't leave us orphans. He comes to us in the person of the Spirit. Now you might say, well, that's kind of a cold, theological, sterile truth. No, it's not. Because when you're going through a trial, when you're going through a challenge, when you need hope, he's not with you. He's in you. He's in you. He's not just with you. He's in you. And so we see the first way Jesus gives us hope is that we don't go through anything alone. He's right in us. The second way that Jesus gives us hope in the present tense, it's found in Romans 8:34. And there we read, who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is the one who died, but even more has been raised. He is also at the right hand of God, and he intercedes for us. Jesus has risen. He's ascended. He's at the right hand of God. And presently, he's interceding for us. The book of Hebrews pictures Jesus as our great high priest. He is the only intermediate between us and God. He is the great intermediate. Nothing comes into our life that's not filtered through him. Our prayers have the great high priest presented to the Father. He is overseeing our lives. Jesus Christ intercedes for you. He hasn't forsaken you. He hasn't left you. He intercedes for you. He's your great prayer warrior. He's your great priest. And the third way that Jesus gives us hope right here in the present tense comes in Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. Jesus is specifically involved in our life. Now remember, the book of Romans was written by the Apostle Paul. He was not an armchair theologian. The things that he wrote about, he experienced firsthand. He knows God personally. And in Romans chapter 8, he continues in verse 31. He says, "What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not even spare his own son, but offered him up for us all, how will he not also with him grant us everything?" What Paul is saying is, if God gave to us his son that cost him everything, how would he not give us the things that cost him little or cost him nothing? He goes on and he says in verse 35, Romans chapter 8, "Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Can affliction or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword or coronavirus?" Well, he didn't say that, but I added that. Certainly, none of those things can separate us from the love of God. He goes down into verse 37 and he says, "Now in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us." We are super conquerors. We overcome, not in the absence of these things, but in the presence of these things. He goes on in verse 38, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life," the greatest enemy, death, can't separate us from the love of God, "nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." My friends, nothing separates us from God's love. We have a tendency to think that when bad things come into our life, that God stopped loving us, or that God doesn't love us enough to care for us. We know that God is always at work, even in the bad things. In that same chapter, Romans chapter 8, we read in chapter 8, verse 28, "We know that all things work together for good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose." Verse 29 continues, "For those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters." He uses everything in our life. Not that everything is good, but he's with us in everything. And in everything he's using. People have asked me, "Is this coronavirus the judgment of God on America?" Well, I can't presuppose God's mind. But I do know that God wants to use everything all the time to bring people to a knowledge of himself and to a deeper walk with him, a deeper trust. I've often shared that when I had my heart surgery in 2013, unemployed, no church, no income coming in, that was one of the greatest times of our lives together as husband and wife, Lori and myself, and one of the greatest and richest times of my personal growth in Jesus Christ. There's an excellent book entitled Don't Waste Your Sorrows. And in that book, Don't Waste Your Sorrows, the premise of that book is, if you go through a trial and you see God's hand in it and you grow through it, then you haven't wasted the sorrow. But if you go through the trial and you harden like clay instead of melt like butter, believing that God is not with you, believing that God is not able, believing that God doesn't care, then you've wasted the sorrow. I had a good friend of mine years ago ask me this question: "Where was God when my dad died?" And my reply to him was, "The same place he was when his son died." God cares. God is at work. Think about it with me in this present tense. He indwells us. He never deserts us. He's interceding for us. He always cares for us. And he's involved with us. He's always able, and he's working to make us the kind of people that he wants us to be. We're all going to face the trials. The question is, will you face it with the perception that God is with you in the present and have hope? Or will you face that trial with believing that God has forsaken you, that God is not able? You're going to face the trial anyway. So let's face it with hope, believing that he's with us. You have that there in your outline. Jesus indwelling assures us he never deserts us. He's always interceding and cares for us. And he's involved, assures us of his ability. That brings us to the third tense. The third tense, the third period of our life where we gain hope. The resurrection of Jesus establishes hope regarding our future. The resurrection of Jesus establishes hope regarding our future. Having been pardoned from our past, completely pardoned by the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, having been indwelled with Jesus Christ in the presence, he's with me every step, every day. What about the greatest enemy? What about the greatest fear? Our personal physical deaths. Well, again, right here in the book of Romans, and there were a lot of verses that I could have used for this message to find hope, but so many of them just emerged from Romans. And we see in Romans chapter 8, if you turn your attention there to Romans chapter 8. And here we read in verse 11, "And if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, then he who raised Christ from the dead will also bring your mortal bodies to life through his spirit who lives in you." There's that indwelling spirit that we talked about. That spirit indwells you. That's the same spirit that rose up Jesus Christ from the dead. That same spirit indwells you. And that same spirit is going to bring your body to life. Now, you may die tomorrow and Christ doesn't return for 100 years. At the return of Christ, that's when your body is going to be resurrected. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 through 58 teaches that when Jesus Christ returns, those who have died in Christ, their bodies will be risen. They will be united with their soul spirit and they will be glorified. But what happens in the meantime? Where's our soul and spirit go? Well, in 2 Corinthians, we read, "Absent from the body, present with the Lord." When a person dies, their spirit immediately goes into Jesus' presence. Paul in Philippians chapter 1 says, "I'm really perplexed. I'm hard-pressed. Do I stay here in this life and help you, or do I die and go to be with the Lord?" Paul believed that when he died, he would be with the Lord. But when our soul spirit is with Jesus, when Jesus returns, he's going to resurrect our bodies. And some have asked me, why is that? Why would he care about our bodies? Because sin brought about the death of the body. And Jesus, by his death and resurrection, has reversed all of the consequences of sin. All of them, including the body. If you're in Romans 8, look with me right at Romans chapter 8, verse 22, because Paul addresses this. He says in verse 22, "For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together with labor pains until now. Not only that, but we ourselves who have the Spirit as the first fruits will also groan within ourselves." We've been given this indwelling Spirit as an evidence that we're going to have eternal life with Jesus Christ. "We also groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for adoption, which is the redemption of our bodies." Our bodies will be resurrected. 1 Corinthians 15 so powerfully describes it. Now, in this hope, and that's our key word for today, we were saved. But hope that is seen is not hope. In other words, if something becomes tangible, you don't need hope anymore, if it's present. Because who hopes for what he sees? Verse 25, "Now if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with patience." We are hoping in the future. We have this great future hope that Jesus Christ is going to resurrect our bodies, that we're going to be with him in eternity. Now, you know, that's a hard concept to understand, isn't it? I can't quite grip eternity. I can't quite grip what heaven's like or what eternal separation is like, hell. I can't grip that. But I do know this. Death is all around us. We see physical death. Every one of us have had loved ones where their soul spirit has left their body and that physical body is dead. Death is a reality. And Hebrews chapter 2, verse 15 says that all men live in fear of death, and because of that, they subject themselves to many other types of slavery. Well, I can't conceive of heaven or hell, but I'm so thankful that I had a guide who came back to life. You know, years ago, I was pastoring in New Jersey, and I had an opportunity to speak at a large conference in Brooklyn. And it was an exciting opportunity, a singles conference, 400 or 500 singles, and I was asked to speak about the grace of God, how it transforms lives, my favorite subject in the Bible. And so I worked hard at that, but I was a little concerned about driving into Brooklyn on a Saturday night, not knowing my way, and my wife Lori suggested that I talk to Ron. Ron is a member of our church there in New Jersey, and he had lived in Brooklyn. And so I asked him, I said, Ron, what's the best way to go? He said, Pastor Jay, I'll take you. So that day came, that Saturday afternoon, Ron and his wife picked Lori and I up, and we were on our way to Brooklyn. And boy, I was so at ease knowing that I had a guide. Didn't have to worry about directions. Didn't have to worry about parking. Didn't have to worry about driving out of there at night, late on Saturday night. I had a guide that led the way. My friends, Jesus Christ is our eternal guide. He came from earth. He really lived a life. He really died. He really rose again. And if you're concerned about death, about what's happened in the future, if you're hopeless, if you're fearful, I want to tell you there is a guide who's gone before you. And the same way Ron gave me peace and hope on that little scale, Jesus Christ gives you peace and hope on the ultimate question, what happens when I leave this life? In the Gospel of John, Jesus' dear friend Lazarus died. And Mary and Martha, Lazarus' sisters, were talking to Jesus. In fact, Martha said, if you had been here, our brother wouldn't have died. And in that context, Jesus speaks these words, John chapter 11, 25 through 26. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, he will live. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Dear ones, Jesus said he was the resurrection and the life. Notice, there isn't resurrection and there isn't eternal life in any church. Anyone that says our church has the way to eternal life, Jesus said he was the way. Religion says by keeping rules, by keeping rituals, and by going through rites, you can make enough positive brownie points with God to get eternal life. The question is, can you be perfect? And God's standard is perfection. Jesus didn't say it was by any religion. It wasn't by any moral works. It wasn't by keeping any set of rules. It wasn't by praying 100 times a day or going through religious rites. It was the fact that Jesus Christ died and rose again. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. And then he simply says, do you believe this? He gives us that option. Do we believe? And belief here isn't mental assent. It isn't mental knowledge about God or about these truths. It says in James that the demons believe but tremble. They know who Jesus is. It's the word belief, pistuo, means to be persuaded to the point of trust. When I was persuaded that Lori was the girl I should marry, I offered a commitment to her. I asked her to marry me, and I committed myself to her. When you were persuaded that the house that you bought was the house, you were persuaded to that, and you committed, you trusted, you put an investment, you put a down payment down, you made an offer. When you are persuaded that Jesus Christ is the God-man who died for you, who rose again for you, you turn from self-trust and you put your trust only in him alone, in Christ alone, by faith alone. That's the message of the gospel. And if you've not done that, you have good reason to be in fear of death. You have good reason to be hopeless about the future. You have good reason to be hopeless about the present because you're going through this life on your own. You have good reason to still be hopeless about your past because those past sins and that all that sin against you and that you've done is still locked in the basement making a terrible racket. But I want to tell you, as we bring our message to a close this morning, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is an historical, objective basis. You know, all the other religions of the world give you rules and rites and rituals, philosophies to keep. We have one thing that we put our trust in, the God-man who died and rose again. It's an objective basis for our hope. Hope regarding our past removes our guilt and shame. To have a clear conscience. Not because you're good, not because you're perfect, but because Jesus Christ did a perfect and complete work. Hope regarding our present. To be able to cope with life, removing our anxiety and having peace. And hope regarding our future removes the greatest fear, the fear of death. And when you can have the fear of death taken out of you, you can have great confidence in living this life. Years ago, I received this beautiful picture as a Christmas present from a man in my church in Indianapolis, Indiana. And it's the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals, Revelation 5:5. A picture, the portrait of Jesus Christ being the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Now on the back of this, and I thought it was still here, for many years there was a note taped that my friend Bill, who gave me this, who taped the note on the back. And it went something like this. He said, I pray the hope and peace of his presence would always be with you. And I want to ask you today, that's my hope for you. That whatever you're facing from your past, whatever you're facing in the present, and whatever we're all facing in the future, that the hope of his presence, not based on conjecture, not based on philosophy, but based on the reality of his person, his death and resurrection. How can you make that so? Well, you see there, if you have the sermon notes, you see there's four closing R's there, four spaces with the letter R. You can have the hope of Easter, the hope of the resurrection, first as you receive him as your personal Savior. You know, biblical Christianity is not religion. It's not keeping rules, rites, and rituals. It's turning from self-trust and putting your trust in him alone. In fact, John 1:12 says, as many as receive him, you receive him. To them he gives the right to become the children of God. He doesn't say as many as are baptized, as many as are confirmed, as many as keep the Ten Commandments. He says as many as receive him. Because, again, either religion is what you do, biblical Christianity is trusting what Jesus Christ has done. And so as many as receive him, he gives the right, the privilege to become his child. Those are the ones who receive him are the ones who believe on his name. We're going to go through the other three R's in just a moment, but I want to pause right now and give anyone who needs to accept Jesus Christ as Savior an opportunity right now. Right now, would you bow your heads with me and pray? Father, I believe Jesus is the God-man. I believe he died on the cross for my sin. I believe the tomb is empty for me. He rose again. Right now, I turn from trusting in my self-life, my self-sufficiency, my self-works, and I ask Jesus Christ to rescue me and be my Savior. Lord Jesus, I trust you and you only by faith alone. In your precious name I pray, amen. If you prayed that and you need to contact us through our website or any way you can. You can find us there online, mountainviewbiblechurch.com, New Tripoli, Pennsylvania. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to rejoice with you. We'd love to be a help to you. Secondly, you need to rest in him. Israel failed to enter into rest because they didn't trust. That's a lesson we see in the Old Testament. It's a lesson that we see in the book of Hebrews. And the writer of Hebrews makes that analogy that they failed to enter into rest. We need to enter into rest by just trusting. And you will never rest in your Christian life if you think that God is still dealing with you in a tit-for-tat relationship. He's now dealing with you in a child, in a parent-child relationship. You need to rest. Bob George, in his excellent book, Clash of Christianity, says, we will never rejoice in our Christian life until we rest in the finality of the cross and the finality of the resurrection. We need to learn to rest, saying, he did it for me. He did for me what I couldn't do for myself. The third R, review. You know, some of these truths we can know mentally, but to have them grip our hearts, we need to go back over the scripture, memorize the scripture. We need to apply the concepts to life to make it really become a part of us so it can go from head to heart to hand to how we live. And then finally, rejoice. Easter is a time of celebration. The resurrection is a time of celebration. Think about it. We have the good news of Jesus Christ. He died. He rose again. He fills us. He's with us. When we understand that death is swallowed up in victory, we have a life here and we have the answer for life to come. Dear ones, that is truly a message that we can rejoice in. As we close our service with a song, I just trust that you will rejoice and that take the rejoicing from this message and carry it right through no matter what you're facing. Your past, your present, and your future. God bless you. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Victory in Jesus.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory.
Angels sing. Much love from the Nilsons. We love you guys.
As we close our service today, let's pray. Our Father God, thank you so much for the gift of your Son Jesus that you sent. Thank you that he lived a perfect life. Thank you that he died on the cross for our sins, but more powerfully than that, that he resurrected on the third day for us. Thank you so much for that powerful love. Thank you for the reminder that we heard today through our music, through the preaching of the Word of God. God, I pray if there's someone watching today on YouTube or on Facebook that hasn't made that personal decision to accept you as Savior of their lives, that today would be the day of their salvation, that you would reach down and powerfully save them. Thank you for the truth and the power of salvation in our lives. Thank you for the difference that it makes and for the joy and for the hope that it brings us. Thank you that we can meet this way even when we can't be together. And God, we'll give you all the honor and glory for the outcome of this service today. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you all again for watching our service today. We're so glad that you were able to come. Follow us, Mountain View Bible Church, on Facebook, on our YouTube. Make sure to visit our website if you have any questions or would like to get in contact with us. Thank you so much. I pray that this Easter is a blessed one for you. Have a good day.